thank you, and welcome to Duke Chapel for the second of the Bach Cantata series this year. We're so delighted to have you with us. And I wanted just to open with a few notes about the first cantata. Tonight you'll hear two cantatas. The first cantata is paired with this Sunday's lectionary, and it is not the most politically correct of all Bach cantatas, but it is one where Bach is definitely trying to teach his congregation. And the lessons have not changed so much in hundreds of years. So he starts with an opening chorus that is quite circuitous and has a fugue subject that you'll hear right away from the bass voices over here. And the text you'll see to it that your fear of God not be a hypocrisy, and do not serve God with a false heart. And Bach uses this fugue subject in its perfect form, and you'll hear other voices sing it in a perfect repetition of it. And as we go through it, Bach, you'll hear this 15 different times. I don't expect you to pick them out because it gets quite complicated. But every time after the sixth iteration of this, he changes it in some way. It's false. It's false-hearted. And it gets more and more false-hearted. And the sin creeps in. And at the end of the piece, the basses once again sing it, almost as if they sung it the very first time, but just with one note different. And I think Bach is telling his congregation, as much as you try to be perfect, you cannot without your love for God. So that is the first movement that the choir sings. Don't be a hypocrite, he says. And the tenor comes out and preaches a little bit more. Bach is very much preaching in this cantata. And he says, today's Christianity is sadly in a sorry, sorry state. And Bach is using some texts that maybe a preacher could not even really use in a sermon. But through music, he's trying to teach and preach. And the tenor goes on to sing an aria. And he says, the hypocrites are like rotten apples. You can be rotten inside and still look perfectly fine on the outside. And then he says, in the bass recitative, he begins to teach a little bit. He comes away from the preacher and begins to teach now in his musical sermon. He says, they who are the same on the inside and outside, they can be called true Christians. And so now he's telling his congregation, this is how you should act. This is how you should be. You should be the same on the inside and the outside. And then, after the bass sings that, we have this lovely lullaby-like soprano aria, Liebster Jesu, with two beautiful instruments you may have never heard before called oboe da caccia. It's a variation on an oboe, and if you'd like to see it afterwards, I'm sure our players will show you. It has a bell-like horn on the end, kind of like a trumpet, and it's a curved instrument. They have a lovely, lovely sound. And the most important part of this movement that the soprano is singing is that Bach has now gone from preaching to teaching to praying. He's teaching his congregation how to pray. And the best way he can do that is through something that is similar to what they experience in liturgy every weekend. He uses this prayer. It says, Liebster Gott, erbarme dich. Dear God, have mercy on me. And then he says, further down, Hilf mir, Jesu. Help me, Jesus, Lamb of God. And then she sings once again, Dear God, have mercy. So he says, God, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. God, have mercy. He's using the Kyrie, Christe, Kyrie, that his congregation would have experienced every weekend in their communion liturgy. Then, at the end of this, he uses the choir to teach one step further so that the congregation can identify, I am a poor sinner. I am wretched with sin. But there is hope in God. And with Bach cantatas, there is always that at the end. There is always hope in God. So we hope you can follow the translations in your texts and enjoy this journey through a somewhat difficult text for three or four movements and find the hope at the end.
Christen, Christen in der Welt, sind auch mit Hammerhorizäer und auf erblasene Pharisäer, die sie von außen fromm bezeugen und wie ein Schiff den Kopf zu Eltern beugen, im Herzen aber streckt ein stolzer Angerung. Haus und tun da selbst die häusliche Pflichten, macht aber dies wohl einem Priester aus. Nein, Heuchler können so berichten.
Es regnet Engel
Thank you.
The next piece we're going to share today is Psalm 42, but set in a very different manner. Dietrich Buxtehude was also a German composer. We performed a piece last week by Buxtehude as well. This one, much smaller scale for a tenor or soprano soloist and two instruments, either violins or recorders or whatever you had in your band. This is an interesting setting for Buxtehude because it sounds less like Buxtehude and more like Monteverdi. Buxtehude in the North German town of Lübeck was somebody who experimented with lots of different styles of writing. Some of his music sounds exactly like and looks exactly like Gabrielli on the page. Lots of brass choirs and six choirs and four choirs. Some of his music looks quite a lot like some of the Italian composers, and this is one of those pieces. So it's for solo singer. And one of the things you'll hear in this piece of music is something that's not so different than pop music today. You're going to hear a bass line. Can we have somebody just, yeah, dumb. So the project is count how many times you hear that. Should be somewhere in the range of 50, 60, or 70, but that two measures will be exactly the same through the entire piece. And so what you have is basically an expression of joy and faith on top of this very dance-like form of music. And so this is Psalm 42. We know it more commonly from the Latin translation, Sicut cervus desiderat fontes, like as the deer, the hart, pants for water. So my soul longs for you, O God. So I will turn it over now to Juliana and the band. So from the highest of highs to the lowest of lows. Part of the Bach series here is to educate us as performers and give people a chance to perform music that is somewhat outside of the normal repertory. And for a singer like Juliana, who can do all of the things that she does with that Buxtehude piece, and then for three fellows like them to sing this piece that Heinrich Schütz wrote. And Heinrich Schütz was quite an influence on Bach. And so it's wonderful to bring that music into context with the Bach cantatas. The final cantata today is one that's a little bit outside of the liturgical functions of his normal cantata work. And this cantata, Für Tankentier, was written for a town council celebration. As the most important musician in Leipzig, holding positions at both the Thomaskirche, the St. Nicholas Church, and the new church, because church attendance had grown so much in the other big churches. He was also responsible for writing some music for city functions. One of his greatest little nuggets of a cantata, that maybe we'll get to someday, is his cantata on the famous Praise to the Lord, the Almighty tune, which was also written for a town council election. And one of the things that we find with these cantatas written for city functions is that they're very much focused on joyous and bountiful praise of God, more so focused on that than the cantatas he uses in liturgical function, which are very focused on teaching scripture and the exegesis of scripture through music. So cantata 29, Für Tankentier, if you've ever sung or heard the B minor mass, you will recognize the opening chorus once we get past the wizardly fast organ part in the symphonia that opens this. I hope you enjoy Für Tankentier. Thank you.
Gerechtigkeit begegnen. gutest Zu-